you to reach in your program and pull out your outline for today. And I want to get started by asking you a question that I'll just bet none of you have asked yourself lately. And yet it's a more interesting question, and it has higher implications for your life than you might initially think it does. And it's kind of an interesting question to unpack. And the question is this: how does a good church stay good? How does a good church stay good? Now, an easier question to answer would be, how does a good church go bad? We could all come up with some quick examples of how does a good church go bad. Nearly 25 years ago, this religious leader promised his faith community that he would serve them, he would provide leadership for them, he would help them rebuild their compound that had fallen into disrepair. Anybody recognize him? David Koresh. Yeah, some of you remember. Also known as the Wacko from Waco. 20 years before him, this religious leader, Jim Jones, was a fairly well-respected Methodist minister in San Francisco, a leader and a humanitarian. But what happened to these two groups? David Koresh, a man who had memorized the New Testament of the Bible by the time he was 12 years old and used to pray as a child with tears running down his cheeks, eventually insisted that he be referred to as the Messiah, and he took 19 wives from among his group, some as young as 12 and 13 years of age, and he beat children as young as 8 months old. And on April 19th, 1993, everything came to this deadly end in Waco, Texas, as David Koresh and 85 of his followers were left dead. A once fairly good group had gone bad. And when it happened, many of us who were old enough to remember couldn't help but think about another deadly scene in Jonestown, Guyana, November of 1978, when the group led by Jim Jones, that had started out as a fairly good group, ended like this, ended badly, with over 900 followers left dead, voluntarily committing suicide for their leader, as Dixie cups of Kool-Aid laced with cyanide dotted the South American landscape. This is where we get the phrase, you've heard it many times, you know, they drank the Kool-Aid. They're drinking the Kool-Aid. This is the scene with which that grows out of. Another good group gone bad. And if the truth were known, there's probably more than a few skeptics who wonder, when is Eastside going to go bad? Is it just a matter of time? And you know, I think that's a fair question and a legitimate concern. In 2009, Eastside became one of the 10 fastest growing churches in the United States out of 400,000 churches of all denominations. In the last 3 years, we've witnessed over 1,000 baptisms into Jesus Christ. We're involved in a multi-million-dollar relocation project right now to a different city. God is doing so many good things here as we pursue Him and as we build community and as we unleash compassion both locally and globally. But deep down, you might wonder, well, how long is it going to be until this good place goes bad? All of us have seen examples of good churches going bad, some with disastrous consequences. Sometimes it's the sexual misbehavior of a leader or a key volunteer. Sometimes it's financial mismanagement or impropriety. It may be the toxic abuse of spiritual authority that leads to the control of the lives of members of the group, a demand of total compliance, no questions asked. It can be extreme legalism. It can be man-made up rules that can't be found anywhere in the Bible. It may be lying. It may be deception. It may be cover-up. It may be a spin on everything public. We've witnessed right in Orange County this past year. An internationally known megachurch brought down and torn apart by bankruptcy and family infighting and nepotism and creditors getting stiffed while insiders are compensated millions of dollars. Sometimes it's conflict in a faith community where there are fights and there are splits and there are divisions. I read about a young rabbi who had a new congregation that he was a part of, and he was having a horrible problem in the congregation. Half of the congregation stood during prayers in their services. The other half sat during prayers in their services, and both insisted that theirs was the true tradition, and they screamed at each other during prayers. He did everything he could to try to bring about peace in the congregation and couldn't resolve it. So finally, he went to the founding rabbi, who was now 99 years old and a resident of a nursing home, and he went to him and poured out his heart, and he said, "Tell me, Rabbi, was it the tradition of the congregation to stand during their prayers?" "No," the old rabbi said. He said, "Ah, then you mean it was the tradition of the congregation to sit during their prayers?" "No," he said, "that wasn't the tradition either." The young rabbi was just frustrated. He said, "Well, I don't know what to do. I've got total chaos on my hands. Half the congregation stands, half the congregation sits during prayers. They're screaming at each other. We've got total problems and disunity." "Ah," said the old rabbi, "that was the tradition." Friends, I think it's time we forthrightly, honestly, and directly asked ourselves this question: how can this good church here at Eastside stay good? How can it stay good? I can tell you right now, it takes three groups of uncommon people who are uncommonly courageous. History shows with painful clarity that if the teachers in the church and the leaders in the church and the members of a church cower and neglect their responsibilities, even the best of churches can eventually go bad. And so today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some short biblical sound bites, some words of warning and wisdom from the Bible to teachers, to leaders, and to members of churches like ours. Now, the first group needed for a church to stay good is courageous teachers. And the first biblical sound bite to teachers is this: teach the Bible. Teach the Bible. I want to ask you to read out loud with me a passage from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Let's read this together. "I give you this charge, preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction." Friends, for a good church to stay good, there have to be those who preach and teach the word of God, the Bible. And those biblical truths must become the belief system, the code of conduct, the moral compass, and the foundation on which that group is built. Waco and Jonestown are just two extreme examples of what can happen in a faith group when people put more authority in a person than they do the Word of God. David Koresh might have memorized big chunks of the Bible in his day, but he obviously did not teach the Bible to his group or apply it appropriately, because child abuse and female abuse and sexual abuse is not compatible with biblical teaching, and it never should have been tolerated. Acts 17 says in the New Testament of the Bible of the Christians in Berea that they examined the scriptures every day to see if what the Apostle Paul said was true. I hope you will always do that. Gene Apple's opinion and Gene Apple's words don't mean a thing if they're not based on Scripture. For a good church to stay good, the Bible must be taught and people must apply it to their lives. Now, the second biblical soundbite to the teachers in a church is don't become ear ticklers. Don't become ear ticklers. That means, teachers, resist the powerful but disastrous temptation to become loved and popular by telling people what it is they want to hear, not what they need to hear. Look at these next verses in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Verse 3 says, "For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear." You see, just like all of you in this room, teachers have an inner yearning to be loved, to be liked, to be appreciated, to be employed. And so there's a constant, powerful temptation in teachers to tickle the ears of the listeners and to massage the minds of the hearts of the listeners in hope of gaining popularity with them. I can tell you right now as a Bible teacher, it's a lot more fun to stand up and teach about God's power for your problems, God's ability to help you through your heartbreaks of life, the purpose that God has for your life, than it is to stand up and teach about sin, than to teach about taking up your cross daily and following Jesus, than it is to stand up and talk about God's plan for managing your money. So God says, teachers, resist the temptation to be ear ticklers, but teach the Bible. Teach it lovingly, honestly, comprehensively. Teach it uncompromisingly, accurately, and teachers, forget about the Gallup polls. Now, you parents know that part of being a good parent is sometimes you have to tell your kids not what they want to hear, but what they need to hear. Don't play in the street. Go tell him you're sorry. Don't stick your finger in the light socket. The Bible says, teachers, love people enough, like parents love their children, that you tell them what they need to hear, even if they don't want to hear it. Now, this third soundbite from the Bible for teachers comes from the next verse, 2 Timothy 4:5. And it simply says, endure hardship. Teachers, endure hardship. I want to put it in this soundbite. Teachers, fight off discouragement. Fight off discouragement. Now, some of you wonder, well, what's so hard about teaching the Bible? That sounds like a cush job. I'll tell you what the hardest part of it is for me. It's not the hours of research. That's hard, but that's not the hardest part. It's not painstakingly writing out word for word in a sermon manuscript what I want to say. That's grueling, but that's not the hardest part for me. It's not preaching and trying to give your best five times every weekend and approach every service as if it's the first service of the weekend. That's exhausting, but that's not the hardest part for me. For me, the hardest part of teaching the Bible is pouring your heart and your soul and your prayers into the teaching, hoping that the lives of the listeners will be transformed by the teaching, and over time realizing there's a lot of yawns and there's lots of people who aren't listening and who aren't being transformed. Fighting off discouragement is one of the toughest parts of teaching the Bible for me. Does that surprise you? Ask any teacher of children or students or adults. That takes a toll on a teacher. Can I share something else that may be surprising to you? Sometimes as a teacher, you have moments where you wonder if you're making any kind of difference at all. You say, Gene, why would you ever feel that way? I mean, the church is growing, people are coming, people seem to understand what you talk about. Friends, it's not the understanding part that discourages me. It is the doing part that discourages me. It's not being just hearers of the word, but doers of the word who apply it. It's the apparent apathy and disinterest that far too many sometimes show about becoming fully yielded followers of Jesus Christ. It seems that too many people seem to equate following Jesus with punching in for a weekend service once or twice a month, and that's kind of the extent of it. And sometimes I think, Gene, haven't you taught them any better than that? Why are only 50% of the adults who call Eastside home here on any given weekend when they know that the Bible teaches, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together? Why do we have to beg and plead for people to get into connection groups when they know the Bible teaches that God calls all of us to be in one of these little units where we experience belonging and growing and serving together? Why is it so hard for hundreds of people to say the C word, commitment, when they've been taught again and again about the one who extended himself on a nail-pierced cross for us? Why do such a small percentage of people who say they follow Jesus and are trusting him for their entire eternal destiny forever and ever not trust Jesus with their tithes and offerings that God can honor them and bless them in light of the one who sacrificed on a cross for them? Friends, sometimes, just honestly, it's enough to make a fragile human teacher like me in a low moment say, maybe you ought to just hang it up. But do you know what the Bible says to frustrated, discouraged, disparaging teachers? Endure hardship. Fight off the discouragement. You know, there are hundreds of teachers in this church. There are kid-side teachers. There are Surge junior high age teachers. There are high school Ignite teachers. There are young adult teachers. There are connection group teachers and Celebrate Recovery teachers and People of the Word teachers, and on the teachers go. And teachers, we need to be reminded, every one of us, if we want this church to stay good, we need to regularly teach the Bible, don't become ear ticklers, and fight off discouragement. Now let's consider next what the Bible says about courageous leaders. It's our understanding of Scripture at Eastside that the elders of the church are given the ultimate responsibility, the ultimate authority to see that a church remains on a true course biblically. The buck stop in the life of a local church is the elders. And it is their responsibility as a team to set the right course. It is their responsibility before God to make corrections when a church starts heading in the wrong direction. And that's why there are passages in the New Testament like Titus chapter 1, which talks about the spiritual character that's needed to serve as an elder. In some churches, it's not the spiritual character of people that qualifies them to serve. They choose the oldest members, or they choose the founding members of the church. In some church, they choose the largest donors. It's like if you make a big enough contribution, it buys you a seat on the board of directors or something like that as one of the largest shareholders. In some churches, it's the relatives and spouses of staff members or staff members themselves, who, of course, have all kinds of conflicts of interest that you can see in that setting. Sometimes it's those who are perceived to have the most biblical knowledge, and Bible knowledge is important, but biblical knowledge without godly character can produce arrogant and sometimes very unloving leaders. And when the wrong people are put in those places of leadership, or if they're serving for the wrong reasons, you just have no idea how quickly a good church can go bad. If Eastside is the only church you've ever known, and that's true for some of you, you may have no comprehension of how quickly things can deteriorate in a local church body. You see, if the right spiritual leadership is not in place, false teaching and theological error can start to go on, and nobody does a darn thing about it. And the place just drifts into theological heresy. Or those who stir disunity in a church, those who say slanderous things about others in the church, never get confronted. Or a church can lose its mission and purpose, and nobody ever does a mid-course correction to try to get it back on course. Or sin patterns go unconfronted, and there's a breakdown in accountability. Or there can be financial mismanagement, or there can be abuse of power, or a loss of trust. I like the descriptive language that the Apostle Paul uses to talk to a group of elders in a church at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 20. He says there, "Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood." And by the way, let me just stop there before we continue in this text for a quick sidebar. You'll notice something in Scripture that whenever elders are referred to, it's always in the plural sense. Do you see that just in this verse? Keep watch over yourselves, elders. Yourselves, plural. The Spirit has made you overseers, plural. Be shepherds, plural. Paul told Titus, appoint elders in the churches. And it is our conviction at Eastside that a church ought to be led by a team, by a plurality of spiritual overseers. And by the way, just so you know, every one of our elders is a non-compensated volunteer who is a member of this church, so there's no conflict of interest there. God knows the vulnerability of groups and churches to a single heavy-handed leader gone unchecked. So in his wisdom, he chose to put the overall leadership responsibility of a church in the hands of a plurality of leaders called elders. I mean, you know it throughout history. In governments, in business, certainly in churches and religious movements, we have seen the devastating impact of a single dominant leader who claims unique power, unique authority, or inspiration that is direct from God.
So Eastside is not, never has been, never will be a dictatorship, and that's healthy. I don't serve on our elder board. I report to our elder board directly. I am responsible to the elder board on my behalf and on the rest of our staff. And frankly, I'm glad I am not solely responsible for this church, because that is more responsibility than I would want to bear. And when things were going good, there would be a tendency to become arrogant and conceited about that. And when things go bad once in a while, as inevitably you're going to hit some bumps in the road, I want some other people to share the blame with me, that I don't have to carry that all by myself. So Paul says to this group of leaders in Acts 20, he says, keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. And then he says, I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard, elders. I like the term Paul uses here to refer to elders as shepherds, because you don't want the group given ultimate authority in the life of a church to be referred to as drill sergeants, do you? No, these are a group of people fueled by love, shepherds with love for God, love for people. And so just like shepherds caring for sheep, elders have a threefold responsibility. First soundbite to courageous elders is feed the sheep. Elders have the ultimate responsibility to see that the sheep are fed, that they get sound teaching at an appropriate level, that babies get milk that they need, that adults get solid food, and that the teaching is challenging at every level and that it's biblical. The leaders around Jim Jones should have said, put away the Dixie cups, Jim. The leaders around David Koresh said, hey, stop making those Messiah claims. We don't want to hear you refer to yourself as Jesus one more time. Soundbite number two to courageous elders, protect the sheep. You know, sometimes a shepherd has to use the blunt end of a staff to ward off predators that would be like savage wolves. And if there's false teaching going on in a church, elders have to confront it. They have to remove it. They have to correct it. If there's divisiveness going on in a church, elders have to deal with it. If there are patterns of immorality that are going on unchecked, elders have to confront it. Elders have to jealously protect the financial integrity of a church, our sense of mission and purpose to make sure we stay on a true course biblically. And so shepherds feed the sheep, they protect the sheep, and third soundbite is lead the sheep. Because elders are given the ultimate responsibility to see that a church remains on a true course biblically. And one of the reasons that I am so proud of our elder team at Eastside, the fact that they're approaching the updating of our corporate documents right now for the future, is that they earnestly take the personal responsibility that they have to shepherd this church seriously before God. So many religious groups run amok because the leaders of the group fall asleep at the switch. Think about this. Thankfully, throughout the entire 50-year history of Eastside, we have not had to live one single day in the fallout of any of these church-busting, integrity-stealing, Christ-dishonoring tragedies that can destroy a church because of the humble, selfless team of elders who have protected us and see that we remain on a true course biblically. How grateful are you for that? And I'll just tell you, one of the biggest reasons that God has blessed this church is we have humble servant leaders with enormous character and humility. I think one of the greatest examples of their humility is how few of you could even name two or three or four of our elders. Why? Because they don't have to be up front. They don't have to have their names in lights. They don't lord over people. They just humbly serve behind the scenes without the need to be recognized. And I think that's extraordinary. And they're even going to be embarrassed by what I'm about to do. But I want to show you a picture of our elders that was taken out at our groundbreaking last May. And let's just thank and honor these guys who serve this church. Now, we've talked about the role of the teachers. We've talked about the role of the leaders and the part they play in this delicate dance to keep Eastside on track. Finally, what about courageous church members? What is the role of the members, the attenders, the participants in a church? You were hoping I wouldn't get to this one, weren't you? Well, the first word from the Bible to the members is, devote yourself to biblical teaching. Devote yourself. If you want to read about the best religious group that's ever been assembled in history, read about the first church in Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. And much of the wonder of the quality of that first church goes back to a little phrase in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, that simply says this: they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Let's say that together. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Now, what was the apostles' teaching? The apostles' teaching is referring to what we would refer today as the New Testament of the Bible. The apostles' teaching. It was the writing of the apostles that became the New Testament of the Bible. You see, those writings hadn't been formed in a book yet. So instead of, you know, being able to say in their gatherings, you know, hey, we want you to turn to 1 Peter chapter 2 today, they would just turn to Peter. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to biblical teaching. They took it in, they applied it, they feasted on it, they made it their personal code of conduct. And when they heard Bible teaching, they didn't like rate it and say, well, we'll give that an 8.5 today, or we'll give that a 9.9, well, that wasn't good enough to buy the CD, or I'm not downloading that on the podcast. They didn't poke their spouse, they didn't poke their friend and say, hey, I think this one's for you today. Notice the Bible says they devoted themselves. Not somebody else, not another group, themselves. They devoured teachings from the Bible. Eastside, do you want to know what you can do as members and attenders and participants of this church that you claim to love so much to avoid this good church ever going bad? You can resolve in your spirit to devote yourself to receiving and applying biblical teaching. Commit yourself to showing up whenever the Word of God is taught, even if you're tired, even if it's raining outside, even if the Lakers are on. And then let's humble ourselves as we're listening to God's Word, and let's say, oh, that's talking about me. I need to apply that to my life. Now, over the next 40 days, we're going to pull out all the stops because we have a goal to help you love the Word of God, learn the Word of God, and live out the Word of God in fresh and powerful ways. And there's four key components to the next 4 weeks. The first is the weekend sermons that I'll be sharing with you. The second, and I think it's probably the most important component of these 40 days in the Word, are the connection groups that we're going to have, because in our connection groups, we are going to teach you how to study the Bible on your own in the next 40 days. Isn't that a skill that you'd like to be able to have, to be able to feed yourself? Then the third component is a daily devotion that I'm going to tell you about in a moment, and the fourth is a scripture memory component. Now, next weekend, I'm going to start with the sermon component, and I'm going to teach you about the inspiration of the Bible. How do you know that the Bible is the Word of God? How do you know that it's true? How do you know that you can trust its wisdom in your life? And we want everyone to get in a connection group. And we've got lots of new groups. We've got 35 brand new groups forming, a total of 155 groups. If you want to start your own group, you can do that. We'll resource you. You got two friends, you know, you can start a group. Wherever two or three are gathered together, Jesus said, there I will be also. But you got to take the step to move toward a group. And then next weekend, I'm going to tell you about how to access a daily devotional where you can just go on a website, you can sign up, and every day during this 40 days, you'll get an email or a text message, whichever you will prefer. And Rick Warren has invited 39 of the top pastors around the country to do these daily devotionals, and another guy named Gene Apple to do one of them. And you'll get these like 5-minute video devotionals that'll come right to your computer screen every day, or right to your phone, or however you do that. That will help you. And then we're going to have 6 verses to memorize over the course of the next 6 weeks, short verses to help you internalize the importance of this. Many of you have a keychain with those verses on them. Now, friends, I believe, I really do, that what can happen in the next 40 days can impact the next 40 years of your spiritual journey. I mean, if you just learn how to study the Bible on your own, what is that going to do to your soul over the next 40 years? But it will only happen if, like the early church, you devote yourself to biblical teaching. You see, when each of us individually commits ourselves to biblical teaching, the quality of the whole church goes up, and gradually we become a better and better and better church. Now, a second word from the Bible to members of the church is, over time, you've got to move from being a consumer in the church to being a contributor. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 12:7 that sometimes people have to be concerned about not just what they can get from a church, and there is a point that you receive from a church, certainly, but you also need to be concerned about what you give for the common good of the group, for everybody else's benefit. Nothing will give you a higher sense of satisfaction about your relationship to this church than when you're making a strategic and consistent contribution to it. What transforms an audience of people into a powerful, loving army is when they become contributors. And contributors just won't let a group run amok because they've got too much invested in it. They've got too much at stake. They're not going to let it go bad. Friends, some of you deep down know it's time in your life for someone to challenge you in your spiritual development to graduate from the consumerism phase of your spiritual life and to develop to the contributing phase of your spiritual life. Now, if you're brand new on the block around here, you know, you're just here today for the first time, you've been here a few weeks, a month or so, I'm not talking to you right now. I'm just talking to those of you who are here week after week after week, and you call this place home, but you know deep down that you've stayed in the consumer phase for much too long. You know who you are because the Holy Spirit talks to us about these kinds of things. And you sense it in your soul right now. Isn't it time that many of you demonstrate your love for Jesus and appreciation for this church that has marked your life and soul by making up your mind to take this step today? Why don't you volunteer to help with something on our Servolution website? Why don't you get started in just giving some of your financial resources to this church so it can get better and better and better? Why don't you make up your mind to participate wildly in these 40 days in the Word? We all need to reach the point in our spiritual development where we're making a contribution for the common good of the church, and that will breathe spiritual life into us. Now, finally, the Bible says to members this one last piece of advice. Willingly and humbly submit to your leaders. Now, let's be honest about something. Typically, we don't like the word submission. We don't like the concept of submitting because we are very independent. And many of you, in your spheres of influence, you're the leader, you're the CEO, you're the manager, you're the class president, the student body president, you're the parent, you're the business owner. You're typically the one who gives direction. But in the family of God, we have a plurality of leaders that we are called to, Gene Apple is called to, humbly and willingly submit to, called elders. I want to ask you to read out loud with me a verse from Hebrews chapter 13. And actually, I'm asking you to read it out loud because these are hard words for us today because we don't like to submit very well. These are going to be hard words for some of you to say, okay? So let's read this together. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy and not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. Friends, God is calling us to have that kind of spirit in the church. Now, that doesn't mean you can't ever have a disagreement with a leader. You can't have a different point of view. You can't express areas of concern. Doesn't mean that at all. But it does mean the tone of voice that you use and the spirit with which you say it are crucial. You see, the real test of your Christian spirit is not how well you lead when you're in charge. The real test of your Christian spirit is how well you follow when you're not in charge. The responsibility on the shoulders of our elders are enormous, and they live every day with the realization they are going to give an accounting to God for the way they shepherded this church. That's daunting. Generally, I don't think churches encourage their elders enough and pump them up enough. Almost the opposite is true. When everything is going great, nobody pats them on the back or says, way to go. But when there's a bump in the road, when there's a problem, when, you know, that happens, they get dumped on, they get criticized, they get accused of being asleep at the switch. I mean, how would you like that job? Few people even know your name, and when you do really well, no one notices, and when one thing goes wrong, everybody blames you. That breed is rare. That job is thankless and the road is difficult, but man, we need them. And so I ask you to pray for your elders, support and thank your elders, bless and encourage your elders, and willingly and humbly submit to their authority and leadership. One of my favorite stories is about a vacation Bible school class of second graders up in Oregon. And one day, these children were gathering, and they had a new student show up who had never been there before, and he was a little boy who just had one arm. And the teacher of the class wished that she had had an opportunity to kind of school the children and prepare them to how to welcome this boy and not make him feel conspicuous, not make him feel like he stood out. But for the most part, the kids did pretty well that day. Until the end of the class, the teacher did what she wouldn't hope the students wouldn't do. And without thinking, she said, hey, let's close the class today by doing that little exercise. This is the church. This is the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. And she looked over and realized that she had done to this little boy what she hoped none of the rest of the students would do. And there was kind of a long, awkward pause for a moment. And then one little second grade girl in the class reached over her left hand and put it in this boy's one right hand, and she said, come on, Davy, let's build the church together. Friends, that's what God is calling us to do. Build the church together. We got something really special happening here at Eastside. And for a good church to stay good, for a good church to get even better, we've got to do it together. And the teacher's got to teach the Bible and not lose heart, not be ear ticklers. And the leaders have to lead boldly and feed the sheep and protect the sheep and lead the sheep. And the members, the participants, you have to devote yourself to God's word. The time comes when you have to move from being just a consumer of the group to a contributor of the group for the common good, and to willingly and humbly submit to your leaders.